Welcome back to the KO Boxing Show. Haven't we got a treat for you tonight? We've got Stan the Man Longinidis. He's been inducted in the Australian Sport Hall of Fame. He's the first martial artist to do that. He's an eight-time world kickboxing champion in three different styles. Stan, welcome to the Boxing Show.
Peter, great to be with you, mate. Always got time for you. Great to be here.
How's COVID treating you, Stan? Because it's shut everyone down. It's sort of an epidemic. No one thought in 2020 when we were at New Year's Eve wishing what the year was going to be about. It just came out of the blue, didn't it?
Yeah, talk about a life changer. I mean, it's definitely affected not just us in this country, but all over the world. And it's fair to say that life as we knew it is going to change dramatically in a lot of different areas. And unfortunately, it's cost, you know, a lot of countries with the economy, so people out of work. I mean, you know, causing a lot of other issues as well, you know, depression. I mean, there's a lot of things that there's going to be in the aftermath. There's going to be a lot of collateral damage as well. So it's definitely a challenging period to go through. And this is one of those times where only the tough will survive. And that's very important right now.
Your brother, George, owns a gym and you're part of that gym. Has that gym been affected? Have you had to shut it down or is it still going?
Well, like every gym, you know, we've had to, you know, conform to the authorities and what they want and the orders, and we can't open the gym, and that's definitely, you know, we've suffered in that department, not only us but also all our members, and you know, we try to stay in touch. My brother's doing a good job using technology through Zoom and all that sort of stuff, but I mean, it's definitely affected us just like everybody else. It's affected my company, you know, Stan the Man Group, my co-founder and partner Maria Petru. You know, our business has obviously suffered like everybody. I mean, it's epidemic. But, you know, having said that, there's a lot to be desired. And, you know, with as we grow older, we like to think we get wiser, and we are skeptical with everything because there's so many different agendas out there.
For sure, Sam. Let's go into the positives. Look, you're the first martial artist to be inducted in the Australian Sport Hall of Fame. And I saw the photos with Cathy Freeman, one of our greats. I love that pic that went up. I think it was in the newspaper somewhere. What was that moment like to be a Hall of Famer? In a round, it's not like kickboxing. This is this Sport Hall of Fame. You're in there with the Cathy Freemans and all the greats. How did that feel? Must have been a great moment.
Yeah, definitely. It renewed my moment of greatness throughout my whole career and life, really. I mean, it was a special event to be in the presence of such a stellar guest list with so many sort of sporting legends of our country. But more importantly for me, like I mentioned on the night, you know, to also have my parents present, because my parents were going through some health issues during that period. And
Stephen and Susie.
And to have them present there for that kind of recognition and acknowledgement was definitely a moment for me that surpasses everything else. Because not too long after that, you know, I lost mum and dad. So it was a special moment for me. But again, you know, to get that recognition, because it all started with a dream, you know, a dream seed that once started with a thought that developed that seed into a dream that I believed and had the audacity to think that I could achieve. And, you know, making big life changes, you know, from once a computer programmer to give up my job and get out of my comfort zone and travel to the US to chase my dream. It was all about trying to put Australia on the map, and to get that kind of recognition from the Sports Australia Hall of Fame is definitely a moment that I will cherish forever.
As fans of yours, Stan, and growing up watching you, I mean, I remember the times it was like Mike Tyson in boxing, Stan the Man in kickboxing, Michael Jordan in basketball. They were the guys that we kind of looked at and we thought that's excellence, because you guys all had the same attitude. We're not only going to win, we want to win spectacular. We want to get the buzz out there. We're going to do our thing. And that was part of your gig, no different to Michael Jordan with the Bulls and obviously other sporting greats. But for you to go to America like you did, as you mentioned earlier, and there was no budgets back then. I mean, you're a guy that grew up in the western suburbs. You didn't have a silver spoon in your mouth. You had to go to America and do it the tough way.
Yeah, well, first of all, it's very flattering to, you know, put my name in the same sentence with some of the names you just mentioned. But, you know, having said that, it was a challenging period. I mean, you know, it was, again, getting out of your comfort zone. I mean, I usually using my public speaking, that I was the sort of kid that was so close with my family, a very close-knit family, that, you know, even when I went on school camps as a kid for 4 or 5 days, I'd be home after 2 because I was homesick. Yeah. So I'm just saying, to get out of your comfort zone, to really believe in your dream. I mean, that's what I try to share today with my mentees and students, you know, when I get a chance to speak. My passion is to add wisdom and knowledge, because the greatest tool that I had was the greatest tool, Peter, that our Creator gave man, and that is his mind. And I truly believed in my dreams that it was going to come to fruition, you know. And that's why today, that's why I try to encourage people with, the most important asset you have is what we believe, you know. And that's what part of life is, you know. When we go to the next stage, and this life's full of seasons, and life is precious. There's a beginning and an end in everything.
Well, look, I remember your career, obviously, because I'm a fight fan. So, and you're a Greek Aussie kid from the West, and there was so much similarities with us Greek people living here, because you were kind of, we're talking late 80s, 90s, that period. Everyone's at the peak of their powers. And I remember going to your fight with Dennis Alexio, and I remember Kerry Packer there. I remember James Packer there. I remember, we mentioned Kathy Freeman before. She was in about row 16. Yeah. We had Eddie McGuire there. It was on Channel 9 News. It was in front pages of the Herald Sun. It was a sold-out crowd. It was just, the buzz in Melbourne was like a Mike Tyson fight. And you were a superstar back then in Australia. Let's call us, around the world as well, martial arts. But the thing that I remember is you were always the same guy, because I remember the after party might have been at the Metro. We rock up. It was just the same Stan as you would see at the gym. It never got to your head, did it, Stan?
Look, again, at the end of the day, it's all about character. And that's one of the most important things that I try to teach. Character is everything. You know, you could be talented, but I'd take good character over talent any day of the week. And it's very, very, very important in what I teach and preach today to young mentees and students. But look, you know, I hear you. That was a time and a season back in the day when we never had pay-per-view. In fact, Christopher Cronus, the co-promoter with that event, I mean, he bought satellite to beam it live at the Metro nightclub back in the day. I mean, because we sold out so early. It was such a big event. It was the hottest ticket in town. Like you said, everyone who was someone wanted to be there that night. And unfortunately, it was an anti-climax of a fight, for those that do recall the fight. It was such a great build-up. And it was publicly the most demanding fight during that period of time. But it was unfortunately a bit of an anti-climax, how it ended so quick. But look, at the end of the day, again, as I share my message with young people today, even that fight, you know, to make that fight to come to fruition, I had to sacrifice so much that people have no idea.
Even pay cuts, because I know Alexei wanted like massive money, and you got like 10% of his purse. Like
you touched. If you want to create a legacy, Pete, if you want to create a legacy, money should not come as an obstacle in your way. I wanted Dennis Alexio.
And I remember your team, they were such great people. You had the late, great Nick Matthews. You had Leroy Michaels, who was really a nightclub figure at Chasers. He was Chasers. You couldn't go with Chasers without seeing Leroy. Yeah. You had Dana Goodson. I mean, you had Nick Canos, who was doing a bit of managing. You had a lot of people back then that had your back, which was great. And it was, your ring entrance was always good. You guys always had number one up, and you had that thing. And Nick Matthews and Leroy Michaels were like...
It's nice, you know, to honour some of these names. It's really nice to honour some of these names. The late Nick Matthews is no longer with us. My great trainer, Dana Goodson, we won all our world titles together, no longer with us. And, you know, we like to think they're up there looking down upon us. You know, at the end of the day, you know, what I'm really proud of is I get so many people, like you say, during your era, you know, during your generation, that would come to me and say, Stan, you know, you don't understand. You were like a god to me, you know, to us, you know, to all the world, you know, to everybody. Like you were, and you inspired us. And these days I get fathers that want to bring their kids to the academy because they all got a story to tell. But, you know, the funny thing is, Pete, they always say to me, when you retired, kickboxing died. It's never been the same. They keep saying to me all the time, back then it was like a cult following, you know. When you fought in Sydney, Queensland, Adelaide, it was like a cult following. You know, it was amazing times in a different period. But like I said, Pete, everything comes to an end.
Let's go into your movie career, Sam, because you were in Trojan Warrior and you were the main star there. And we had a lot of actors in that. That was a great film. I really enjoyed it. Your Ring of Fire, you're in Blood Fist. How did that come about, that part of your life going into movies?
Me in movies is not something, you know, there's a lot to talk about or discuss. Not that I had a lot of success in it, but I had a lot of opportunities. But again, it was like at the time, I didn't want a distraction. You know, when I went to America, you know, I started making a bit of a name for myself. I was winning my fights. I was part of the Jet Center, the very infamous Benny the Jet, you know, and every time I fought every 6 weeks at the Hollywood Palladium, it would be, you know, full of Hollywood stars, and I would be building a name. You know, Australia was the flavor of the month back then. Stan the Man, the Thunder from Down Under. I was trying to market myself with a bit of charisma. Every time I knocked people out, I throw little stuffed koalas in the audience, trying to market myself. So I was doing the right things, and I was building a following. And so, you know, at the end of the day, it's, you know, again, you know, when you mentioned my name amongst some, you know, legends in sport, and the thing is, you got to have something about you that brings value to someone who purchases a ticket. You mentioned before, you know, the music I came out to, it was like a theatre, you know, I'd come in with the splits and show a bit of showmanship. So, you know, I even teach people today that, you know, even showmanship is very important. You know, you want to be a people's champion, but there's a very fine line, you know, to be a showman and be humble, but cross the line and get a bit too cocky when the audience then says, oh, I want to see this guy get bashed, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, look, that's very true. Probably similar to Anthony Mundine. I mean, he sometimes, he's a showman, he produces, and then sometimes people don't like it. But your career, you had 103 kickboxing fights. I mean, that is unbelievable. That's old school. That is as old school as you can get. I mean, that is a massive amount of fights. I know that's probably an area that's past you, and like you're feeling, well, it's not really me anymore. I'm not that guy that had 103 fights. You're now the guy that does motivational speaking. You've got Stan the Man Group, which you formed with Maria. And obviously, you also had a health problem. So it's not like you're this big superhero. Stan is, you know, he's a human and things can go wrong. Let us know about that, Stan.
Yeah, look, most definitely, you know, I share with people that I built my mind over 15, 20 years. I built my mind to be fearless, you know, for me, there's nothing more liberating to conquer fear than get into the ring and face a combat, you know, your combat and opponent. And for me, you know, that's the most important thing that I try to share with people, that everything comes to an end, but I was a guy that was fearless of any opponent. But when you don't see an opponent and you have a health issue, what can you do, Pete? I mean, what can you do? You are in the hands of what?
The doctor.
Whatever it is you believe.
Science.
You know, I'm just saying. Yeah. You know, you can do what you want. You can think positive. And that's my mind. That's what I do, people. I'm a motivational speaker. The power of mindset is everything. And you can think positive, and it's a good thing. Better to think positive and have good energy. But at the end of the day, there's a beginning and an end. And we never know when the end will come. You know, and that's part of my message today with our work that we do with Stand the Man Group. You know, like we're saying at the end of the day, we customize for any kind of company or any kind of situation. It's all customized. Marie's got over 20 years of strategy. She puts programs together. She does all the hard work and strategizes everything to customize for our service. And I just kind of rock up and do what I do. But, you know, to me, that's where we're at today. Life is full of seasons. And the message that I want, you know, your audience to take away more than just what I've achieved in my sport, because like I said, you know, it comes to an end. But what I'm hoping today is through the messages and the wisdom that we share is to empower people that, you know, I know when we're young, we have all these desires and dreams because we've got a whole life ahead of us. But, you know, there's nothing more important than discovering what is your purpose. There's one of those great quotes that says that two great things about life, when you are born and when you realize why. And when we're young, and I say this because it's all part of personal development. We are always growing and developing. And for you to discover what is your vision, what is your purpose, what are your goals? And as we get a little bit older, Pete, we have a bit of life experience. Hey, life hits us sometimes with some tough challenges. Sometimes we're going to get knocked down. And if you are weak-minded, Pete, if you are weak-minded, you're going to quit. And quitting becomes a habit. This is why I'm saying to you that weak-minded people will suffer in the world. So what we've got to do is build our power of mindset. As we get older, Pete, you are now, you know, we're in our 50s, you know what I'm saying? We're late 40s, we're a bit of life experience. We need to have some kind of belief system. What's your philosophy about life? What is the meaning of life? You know, you watch people, we all die, bro. It doesn't matter who you are, how much money you've got. There's a beginning and an end. We've seen people, they all pass away, celebrities, icons. It doesn't matter who you are. We all die. In life, we're going to lose loved ones. Life has never been the same for me, Pete, after I lost my mother and my father. Where did they go? What is it we believe? And this is where I'm saying, you know, for me, how do you define success? I have a lot of clientele. They have all the money in the world, Pete. But they confessed to me they were happier before they became successful. How do we define success?
Things are simple. If things are simple in your life and they're not complicated, because pressure does make you unhappy sometimes. It's successful in someone else's eyes might not be successful in the person's body because he's got pressure to then live up to that success, whether it's financial, meeting targets or whatever. But when life's simpler and you're just you and you're with your family and friends, you probably haven't got the money and the brand new Mercedes, but you've got a nice car, you've got a house in the suburbs. You've got more time to do things that you want to do with loved ones, and you're not pressured to do things because success carries a tag, whether it's a sporting field, whether it's a business field. If you're a successful salesman, you're going to keep those sales up. That means you might have to work 7 days a week. But if you're a guy that just makes enough and you're on wages and you're happy, you're going to get your Saturday and Sunday to go and watch your footy, go to the soccer, watch boxing, whatever, because that's what life's about, to me anyway. But I know exactly what you're saying. And different.
Again, I hear you, bro. I hear you. And that's part of the discussion because everyone's got an opinion. Hey, I'm an opinionated sort of guy. I'm bold. I'm passionate about what I believe. But what I'm saying to you is this. A lot of people have dreams, Pete, and they achieve them. And they achieve them. Oh, but once they get there, they realize, you know what? The grass is not really that much greener on the other side. And what happens? The weak-minded, they fall into a little bit of anxiety and depression kicks in. Because, hey, there's no fulfillment, Pete. This is what I'm saying. Hey, you know, I know people that have got everything they've ever wished for, everything they've ever wanted, and they're not fulfilled. You know what I call those people? The ultimate failure in life. Because that's the ultimate failure, when you've got everything you've ever wanted and you don't find fulfillment. So how do we find fulfillment? Now, we could sit there and we could talk, you know, in a secular way and without offending people. But hey, I'm bold about what I believe. I've come to know something that I will not compromise. And I'm a man of faith. I'm a man of faith.
Christian, which is great. Well,
I don't speak passionate about it, you know, because my mum taught me to go to church or people told me to go to church. I speak about my faith because I experienced him in my life. And I will never, I've come to know something that I can't live without, Pete. So what am I saying? Part of my character now and the chemistry in my personal development is my biology and my theology is combined. It's part of my life. Why? I'll give you an example of how I live. When I wake up in the morning, Pete, and I take my first conscious breath, I know who I thank. And I say that. And every time I say that, Pete, I choke up in my throat because two of our best mates we lost while they went to bed at night. They never knew they were going to wake up. That's how precious life is. So what I'm saying is at the end of the day, when you know you are blessed, then you should know who you thank for your blessing. When you know who you are, then you know who you are not. That's the most important thing everyone has got to discover in our life journey. We come to a point in our life and we say, what is life about? Where's my mum? Where's my dad? Where are they gone? And let me tell you something, Pete. Where I draw my strength and my comfort is I believe that my dad, who recently passed away, has reunited with my mum in the promised land.
Yeah.
And one day I'll see them again. that gives me hope in something, as opposed to living a shallow life, just simply existing.
No, very well said, Sam. Very well said. Now, moving on to what's in store for Stan now. What are we going to see? Because we've seen Stan, you know, the greatest kickboxer of all time, Hall of Fame. You've had all the accolades, movie star. What's next for Stan? Motivational speaker. You've got Stan the Man Group. Where are we going to see Stan in the next 20 years? I know you want to make a difference to people's lives as well. You want to kind of like make kids, you know, have a purpose in life, give them some type of probably guideline, some type of rail, because at the moment it's a lot tougher on kids because of social media, Stan. Growing up for us, we didn't have Facebook where someone posts something up and then 20 people talk about that person. Social media now has made life great, and it's also been sort of deterrent as well for kids growing up.
Yeah, definitely. Look, it has its pros and cons, you know. But having said that, there's a lot of good things, you know, if we can somehow control and guide them. You know, our concern for our kids is about giving them a good start. And this is what I'm saying to you. While they're still young, and when they're young, they grow quick, it's very important to be able to share with them some good old-fashioned values, you know what I mean, that have evaporated from our generation. I mean, I got brought up by a mother that taught me values like think before you speak. You got nothing positive to say, then don't speak at all, she'd say to me. My mum also taught me values like, hey, don't do to other girls that you wouldn't want done to your sister. I mean, I'm just saying, they're great values that help build a character. You know, when a child is born, he's not racist, okay? Yeah. But then it's a chemical balance that he starts to bring into his mind, and what he hears, what he sees, and et cetera, et cetera. This is what I'm saying to you. It's all part of personal development. And this is now, I mean, where is my season now? You're asking me, look, at the end of the day, I've got some health issues that I'm challenged with and dealing with. Again, all I can do is surrender them to the Lord, Pete, because in the last 5 years, I've been through quite a few things. You know, if I just throw a few things at you, like, you know, in the last 5 years, I've survived a severe aggressive stage 3 bowel cancer, you know, where they removed the tumor bigger than a tennis ball. They removed 2/3 of my intestine and reconstructed my bowel. I've had 2 double hernia operations that have been infected, and I'm still in pain. I've been diagnosed with a heart and a lung condition. That's why, you know, I have problems with my respiratory. I'm doing okay right now as I speak with you, but I'm trying to monitor myself. I mean, there's a lot of different issues that, you know, I'm very susceptible for a heart attack or a stroke if I don't strictly take my medication. But as long as I'm kicking, Pete, my passion is, you know, with what we do with Stan the Man Group, every time I get an opportunity with Maria putting together programs, you know, with all her work and just to be able to share with people some wisdom and knowledge that I can help empower them to give them a good start in life. And that's my passion right now.
No, that's great to hear, Stan. And look, for all the younger people that are watching you, as we mentioned before, you're an inspiration. You're one of our, you know, not only an idol, but a person that was always, you know, a figurehead as far as young people. You were a mentor, role model. Everything you had to be in a person. It was also the most important thing. You were down to earth and humble. You always had time for people. You were great to your fans. So, you know, I mean, you remind me in that way, the way you do your life and things. Similar, say, to a Manny Pacquiao. He's a born-again Christian. He's there for his fans. When you were asked to step up, you stepped up in spades. There's never any question marks on your performance. And all the great ones do that. We mentioned before Michael Jordan. We mentioned Cathy Freeman, we mentioned Mike Tyson, you know, we mentioned Manny Pacquiao. Each time those dudes were asked to step up, and Cathy, a female, they stepped up in spades, and so did you. And as fans, that's all, that gave us a lot of joy, and it gave us a lot of hope in our life as well, that we can achieve things. So it's great that we had this opportunity to interview you. I know once COVID's over, we're going to turn up to the gym, and we're going to do a bit more of a different type of interview, but this is great content to have now, and we really appreciate your time and everything. I mean, is there a message that you'd like to give the people that are watching out there, Stan, before we sign it off?
Look, at the end of the day, like I said, life is precious. You know, dream big, But more important than anything, believe in your dreams. Be prepared to work hard. Any place worth going, you got to pay a price. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, like I said, you know, there's nothing worse than wasted dreams. So, and, you know, most important thing that I want to share to everyone, not only from the younger people, but also people that are getting a bit on in age. Again, the most important thing that we need to discover, Pete, in our life is the greatest mystery about life. You know, what is life? What's the meaning of life? And it's something that I try to encourage people that is a very important topic of interest, you know, as we try to prepare for life and enjoy life and make the most of life. There's going to come a time where we've got to prepare for our death and what it means and what we believe. Like I said, what you believe is the most important thing. Each to their own for whatever works for them. You know, you might say, well, you're a born again Christian. What does that mean? The Catholics aren't going to get to heaven. What about the Muslims? What about this? Hey, each to their own, whatever works for them. If whatever you believe gives you peace in your heart, then something's working for you. God bless you. Good luck, dear. All I'm saying is, it's like everything else, Pete. You know, you got to work on it. You got to work on something. What's your relationship with God like? You know, not that good. You spend much time on it. You invest time in it. It's like everything. My analogy is the same with everything. You could come to the gym every day, I tell my students. You can come to the gym every day, but if there's no progression, you're wasting time, your own time. You can go to church every week, but if you walk in and walk out the same way for 30 years, you have not developed, you have not grown. So at the end of the day, it's what you believe. Now, if you believe strongly in something, then that's your rock. No one will move you. And then when our time is up, Pete, we'll face the God we think we know.
No.
And we'll face that judgment day, each to their own. Because when my time is up, you won't be there as my voice piece to represent me against the judge. You know what I mean? We're all running our own race.
No, well said, Stan. Thank you for your time, my brother. Well, I mean, I know we could say eight-time world champion and all that. We can keep saying, but you're just a great man and a great human being. And thank you for your time. And looking forward to doing a great interview back at your gym with your brother as well, George Long. And he's another undefeated world champion. So here, the bloodlines run thick. And thanks to your time, my friend. We'll be back soon.
No worries, Pete. Love you, Pete. God bless you, bro.
Thank you. Love.